Hello everybody and welcome to video number 9 of the free online version of the Fusion Research Lecture. We are in chapter 2, magnetic field configuration, and you might remember that in the last video we talked about the existence of flux surfaces. And in this video we will talk about something which you might have seen already towards the end of the last video, and these are magnetic islands. So to start with, here are two photographs of the flux surface structure in W7X on the left hand side. So this is W7X, and on the right hand side we have W7AS, the predecessor of W7X. And to start with, on the right hand side, maybe this is a classical Poincaré plot. On the left hand side, this is a Poincaré plot overlaid with an image of the field line made visible, having some residual gas inside of the plasma and then inserting an electron beam or applying an electron beam to it. And you can see now again back to W7X on the left hand side, one flux surface. And on this flux surface, you see at the very edge a few structures appearing there. And these are magnetic islands. So these are structures encapsulated in the background configuration here and here and here as well. And on the right hand side, you can even see that maybe in a few cases, yeah, here for example, in this case, you can even see that within these structures there are encapsulated flux surfaces as well. Yeah, so these magnetic islands are basically nested flux surfaces encapsulated in the background configuration. Okay, so let's write down a few facts about magnetic islands. Magnetic islands are, as I said, nested flux surfaces encapsulated in the unperturbed background configuration, in the unperturbed background configuration. Now, magnetic islands can be bad for the confinement. Magnetic islands can be bad for the confinement. Why is that the case? Now, to understand that, let's have a look back at the picture on the left-hand side. So if we just look on this island here, so at this island here, this one, then we see that via this island there are regions connected which would usually be radially separated, because these islands are also spanned by a magnetic field line, meaning that this position here is connected via this position due to the magnetic field line going around the torus. So there's a radially shortcut, if you want, from here to here. And this, of course, can lead to enhanced transport losses. So it's bad for the confinement because we have the radial transport via the parallel mobility. Remember that the parallel mobility, so parallel refers here to the direction along the magnetic field, of course, is very high, whereas perpendicular to it, it would be very slow. And now having the radial transport via the parallel mobility can be something very bad. Now, flux surfaces with a rational QS are sensitive to perturbations due to resonant effects, and these perturbations are magnetic islands. Now, in general, flux surfaces with a rational safety factor QS, for example 1 or 2 or 3/2 or whatever, those flux surfaces are sensitive to perturbations, basically this is due to resonance effects. So an initial perturbation can easily grow on these flux surfaces. and then can reside in a magnetic island. So magnetic islands, are more likely to appear there. Magnetic islands can appear on these flux surfaces where the safety factor QS has a rational value. Magnetic islands are thus also characterized by the Mode number. So magnetic islands are characterized by the Mode number M, which is the poloidal Mode number. And N being the toroidal Mode number. So the periodicity basically into each of these directions. And since I said the islands are more likely to appear at rational values of the safety factor, at flux surfaces where we have a rational value of the safety factor, then M over N is equal to QS at these flux surfaces. So this is an important thing we need to keep in mind. Now let's have a look at an example. So here you can see, you can see a magnetic field line. So here let's first look at the magnetic field line, which goes around the torus like this. Then it continues here like this, continues along the, along the toroidal direction. Now we have one toroidal circumference. It continues here, of course. Then goes along like this, and then it finishes its poloidal circumference as well, meaning that here this field line has a safety factor of, a safety factor of QS equals to 2. So we needed two toroidal circumferences for one poloidal circumference. And then you see these four poloidal cross sections. So 1, 2, 3, 4, right? And on each of these cross sections, you can see there are two islands appearing here. So we have an M equals 2 magnetic island structure here. So we have M equals 2 magnetic island structure appearing here as an example. Now, as another example, here we have unrolled the flux surface. So here we have kind of unrolled the flux surface. What do I mean by that? So if you have a close look, you can see that here the more or less horizontal coordinate r times phi, this is the toroidal direction. So this is the toroidal direction, unrolled the toroidal direction, and the vertical coordinate, you see r theta, this is the poloidal direction to which we have unrolled it. And then you can see we have three islands appearing here. So 1, 2, 3, a periodicity of 3, a Mode number of 3, meaning we have here an M over N equal to 3, and then the periodicity into the toroidal direction is only 1, so it's a 3-1 magnetic island which we have here, a 3-1 magnetic island. And here you can again nicely see the structure of the flux surfaces inside of the island. So you have closed flux surfaces inside of the magnetic island as well. Okay, let's have a closer look at this structure by making a drawing. So let's try to draw a magnetic island with an appropriate coordinate system, something like this, and then here into this direction. So here we have the radial coordinate, and then here the vertical coordinate. This is xi, which corresponds roughly to the poloidal direction, but is more generally referred to a magnetic coordinate. to a magnetic coordinate. And then in the center of the island, we have a magnetic axis as well, and around it, the first flux surface, and then another one, and then another one, and then another one where the next island kind of connects, for example, like this. And then we have a few distinguished points here. So this one and this one. These are the X points. So this is the X point of the island. Here's another X point. Then in the center, this is called the O point of the island. So the magnetic axis of the island is called the O point. And then the last flux surface of the island, if you want, this is called the separatrix. Yeah? So here we have the separatrix. It has its own separatrix, the island, which is basically this flux surface here. Yeah, so this one. Okay. The island, now how is the island generated? So to understand how the magnetic island is generated, let's draw next to it the let's draw next to it the required magnetic perturbation, which we need to generate the island, because the island is generated by perturbation in the background magnetic field. So now we have again the coordinate xi, and now we have a radial magnetic field perturbation here. So because in general magnetic islands are generated by a periodic radial perturbation of the magnetic field, by radial magnetic field perturbation. How can this look like? So let's first look where we have the characteristic points. So this is the X point. Here we have the O point, this is the next X point. And then the perturbation in the magnetic field might look, for example, like this. So some kind of a sinusoidal, which is periodic perturbation, where we have here a negative one, BR being smaller than zero, here a positive one, BR being larger than zero. And this, as you can probably easily imagine, can be caused by a current filament along the field line. So this can be caused by a current filament, along, let's write a proper sentence here. So this can be caused by a current filament along the rational field line, along the corresponding rational, well, we assume here we have along the rational field line, basically in the O point. That's how we generate, or how magnetic islands are generated. Now, an important parameter to characterize islands is the width of the island. So the width is this size here. So this one is defined as, the width of the island, W. And a few words to say about the island width. Now, by calculating the magnetic fluxes, it can be shown, which we are not doing here, that the width of the magnetic islands can be approximated by the following expression: 4 times, and then R naught squared times BR, where R naught is the coordinate of the resonant surface, So back to the formula for the denominator, we then have M, the molten number, B, theta, the poloidal magnetic field, and the shear at the coordinate, and then the square root of that expression. Now, looking at that equation, we can deduce a few things from that. First of all, the island size increases with Br, so the perturbation of the radial magnetic field, not surprising. Maybe more interesting is that it decreases with the poloidal mode number M, it decreases with the poloidal mode number N, and in addition, it decreases with magnetic shear S. And that is interesting, right? So just to be explicit here, shear limits the island width. Shear limits the island width. And remember when we talked about potential benefit of magnetic shear by introducing it in the beginning of chapter 2, here you can see the potential benefit of magnetic shear, which can limit the width of magnetic islands. Magnetic islands typically rotate in a plasma, so magnetic islands can rotate and the frequency is on the order of 10 kilohertz. Okay, now a few words about causes and consequences of magnetic islands. So let's talk about causes and consequences. Consequences of magnetic islands. So let's focus on tokamaks for now. Because you know that tokamaks are generated by a large current flowing in the plasma, so it's maybe more likely that islands play a more important role there. As we will see, they play an important role in stellarators as well, but let's first look at tokamaks. So in tokamaks, you can easily imagine as well that there might be some kind of initial perturbation, in the current profile. Just due to, for example, a fluctuation of the electron temperature, variation of the electron temperature, changing the resistivity, which changes the current profile. Now, a perturbation in the current profile, as we have just discussed, can generate magnetic islands. Now, magnetic islands, as I have also tried to explain at the beginning of this video, can lead to increased radial transport, and this can lead to a local flattening of the profiles, And if we just look at the temperature profile, the flattening of a temperature profile, this changes resistivity. And this enhances, so further enhances the initial perturbation. And then we have something which is a tearing mode, something we will discuss in the next chapter, but it is important enough to mention it already here, a tearing mode, which is a type of an instability. And this instability, as we will see, can be very dangerous because it can lead potentially to disruptions. And a disruption is something which we want to avoid at all costs in a large scale experiment, because a disruption basically means the sudden loss of confinement. Within a very short amount of time, And if you imagine the sudden loss of confinement of a mega amp of current circulating in the plasma, then it immediately induces mirror currents in the vessel wall, in the metallic structure, the metal structure surrounding the plasma. That, of course, can induce a lot of mechanical stress. And this is what we want to avoid in large-scale experiments. And don't worry, we will talk about disruptions in more detail in one of the next videos. Now, let's look at an example. So here is illustrated a so-called NTM. So-called NTM, which is a neoclassical tearing mode in ASDEX Upgrade. In ASDEX Upgrade, this is a neoclassical tearing mode, is a certain type of instability. It is called neoclassical because there is the so-called bootstrap current involved. And these are all things which we will discuss in the future videos, but I just wanted to show it here because I think it's a nice example. So first of all, we have a poloidal cross-section on the left-hand side where we have an M equals 3 island structure. So 1, 2, 3. And then you can see that over the on the right-hand side is a plot which shows two electron temperature profiles. The black filled circles are for the unperturbed case without magnetic islands. The open circles are for the case with the island. And you can see that across the island, so this is the width, this is across the width of the island, the temperature profile flattens, and then the overall temperature profile is reduced due to the island being present there. Now a few last words. So in tokamaks and stellarators, islands are caused by external, can be caused by external error fields, for example, due to some metal structures surrounding the experiment. So in tokamaks and stellarators, external error fields from some kind of metal structures surrounding the experiment can cause magnetic islands. Oops, can cause magnetic islands. So before you install something at your experiment, you have to be aware of how this installation interacts with the magnetic field of the tokamak or stellarator, and be sure that you do not create unwanted islands. Now in stellarators, magnetic islands can naturally occur. They can naturally occur from the vacuum configuration. And they can be actually beneficial. For in stellarators, for example, there is the concept of a magnetic island diverter. Remember when I talked about diverters being important basically as an exhaust for the plasma? Somebody once said it's like a vacuum cleaner for the plasma, getting out the impurities. And if you have now in a stellarator a magnetic island around the structure, so at the very edge, around the plasma, and then if the outermost side of the island ends at a diverter plate, this is a very, can be a very efficient way to direct your impurities to a diverter structure. And this was first explored in W7AS and is also explored in W7X, just as an example, that islands can also be very beneficial in stellarators, for example. Okay, that's it for this video where we talked about magnetic islands, which are nested flux surfaces encapsulated in the unperturbed background configuration. These are generated by a radial periodic distribution of the perturbation of the background magnetic field, which can be caused, for example, by a current filament along the field line. We talked about the island width, how this can be decreased with increasing magnetic shear. And I also told you that a magnetic island can lead to a disruption, which is something which we want to avoid or have to avoid at all costs in large-scale experiments like ITER. I also told you that islands can, however, be beneficial in stellarators. For example, there is the concept of a magnetic island, a diverter being explored in W7X, which is actually helpful to direct the unwanted impurities in the plasma towards the buffer plates into the diverter structures. That's it. Hope to see you in the next video.